ॐ शन्नो मित्रश्चं वरुणः शन्नो भवत्वयमा शन्न इन्द्र बृहस्पतिः शन्नो विष्णुरुक्रमः नमो ब्रह्मणे नमस्ते वायो त्वमेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्मासि त्वमेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्म वदिष्यामि ऋतं वदिष्यामि सत्यं वदिष्यामि तन्मामवतु तद्वक्तारमवतु अवतु माम् अवतु वक्तारम् ॐ शान्ति शान्तिः ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः ॐ यश्छन्दसा मृषभो विश्वरूपः छन्दोभ्यध्यमृतात् सम्बभूव समेन्द्र मेधया स्प्रणद अमृतस्य देवधारणो भूयासं शरीरं मे विचर्षणम् वा मे मधुमत्तमा कर्णाभ्यां भूरि विश्रुवं ब्रह्मणः कोशोऽसि मेधया विहितः श्रुतं मे गोपाय ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः ॐ अहं वृक्षस्य रेरिव कीर्तिपृष्ठं गिरेरिव ऊर्ध्वपवित्र वाजिनी वस्वमृतमस्मि द्रविणगुंसवर्चसं सुमेधा अमृतोक्षितः इति त्रिशङ्कोर्वेदानुवचनम् ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः ॐ पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः ॐ आप्यायन्तु ममाङ्गानि वाक् प्राणश्चक्षुश्रोत्रमथ बलमिन्द्रियाणि च सर्वाणि सर्वं ब्रह्म उपनिषदम् माहं ब्रह्म निराकुर्याम् मां ब्रह्म निराकरोद् अनिराकरणमस्त्वनिराकरणं मे अस्तु मनिनिरतेय उपनिषत्सु धर्मास्ते मयि सन्तु ते मयि सन्तु ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः ॐ वाङ् मे मनसि प्रतिष्ठिता मनो मे वाचि प्रतिष्ठितम् आविराविर्मेधि वेदस्य माणिस्तः मे मा प्रहासे अनेनाधीतेन अहोरात्रान् संदधामि ऋतं वदिष्यामि सत्यं वदिष्यामि तन्मामवतु तद्वक्तारमवतु अवतु माम् अवतु वक्तारमवतु वक्तारम् ॐ शान्ति 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 ॐ भद्रं नो अपि वातय मनः ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः ॐ भद्रं कर्णेभिश्रुणुयाम देवाः भद्रं पश्येमाक्षभिर्यजत्राः स्थिरैरङ्गैस्तुष्टुवागुंसस्तनुभिः व्यशेम देवहितंयदायुः स्वस्ति न इन्द्रो वृद्धश्रवाः स्वस्ति नः पूषा विश्ववेदाः स्वस्ति नस्तार्क्ष्यो अरिष्टनेमिः स्वस्ति नो बृहस्पतिर्दधातु ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः ॐ यो ब्रह्माणं विदधाति पूर्वं यो वै वेदांश्च प्रहिणाति तस्मै तं ह देवमात्मबुद्धिप्रकाशं मुमुक्षुर्वै शरणमहं प्रपद्ये ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः ॐ नमो ब्रह्मादिभ्यो ब्रह्मविद्यासम्प्रदायकर्तृभ्यो वंशर्षिभ्यो महद्भ्यो नमो गुरुभ्यः सर्वोपप्लवरहितप्रज्ञानघनप्रत्यगर्थो ब्रह्मैवाहमस्मि ॐ नारायणं पद्मभवं वसिष्ठम् शक्तिं च तत्पुत्रपराशरं च व्यासं शुकं गौडपदं महान्तं गोविन्दयोगीन्द्रमथास्य शिष्यं श्रीशङ्कराचार्यमथास्य पद्मपादं च हस्तमलकं च शिष्यं तन्तोटकं वार्तिककारमन्यानस्मद्गुरून् सन्ततमानतोऽस्मि श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानाम् आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं लोकशङ्करं शङ्करं शङ्कराचार्यम् केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वन्दे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेदि मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः
Brihadaranyakopanishad is a text that we begin this morning. It is Upanishad and is a part of Shukla Yajurveda. As you know, in Yajurveda there are two recensions, Krishna Yajurveda and Shukla Yajurveda. Taittiriya Upanishad belongs to Krishna Yajurveda, whereas Ishavasya Upanishad and Brihadaranyaka Upanishad belong to Shukla Yajurveda. Of that, the Ishavasya is found in the Samhita section of the Shukla Yajurveda. Therefore, it is called Samhita Upanishad. And Brihadaranyaka is found in the Aranyaka section of the Shukla Yajurveda, in the Shatapatha Brahmana. And therefore, this is a Brahmana Upanishad. Brahmana generally is a text which is looked upon as an explanation of the Samhita. And therefore, sometimes it is said that Brihadaranyaka Upanishad is an exposition, a very detailed exposition on the Ishavasya Upanishad. Some mantras are also found here. And Shankaracharya himself will explain why it is called Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. It is Brihad because it is voluminous, it is large in size. And it is called Aranyaka because it is meant to be studied in Aranya or in the forest. So in the Vedas, we have the Karmakanda, we have the Samhita, we have the Karmakanda, we have the Aranyaka, and we have the Upanishads. These Upanishads are found sometimes in Brahmana section, sometimes in Aranyaka section, and only once in the Samhita section, that is the Ishavasya Upanishad. Brihadaranyaka is found in the Aranyaka section, and therefore it is called Aranyaka. It is Brihad, it is very large or voluminous, and therefore it is called Brihad. So Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, a large text Upanishad, which used to be studied in the Aranya, in the forest. Generally speaking, the Aranyaka texts are those which consist of Upasanas. So Karmakanda or Brahmana section consists of the various rituals, Dharma Shastra, which is fit to be performed by a grihastha. Whereas the Aranyaka section mainly consists of Upasanas, which are performed by the people who are retired, Vanaprastha. So who are the people who live in Aranya or the forest? The Vanaprastha, the retired people. And therefore Aranyaka section usually contains the Upasanas. Therefore Brihadaranyaka also has number of Upasanas. However, the whole text is looked upon as Upanishad, because even the Upasanas which are here are also meant for Brahma Vidya, not only for the sake of Upasanas, and therefore the whole text is looked upon as Upanishad. It consists of 6 chapters. And they have named the 6 chapters are looked upon as consisting of 3 Kanda or 3 sections. First 2 chapters form 1 Kanda called Madhu Kanda. Second 2 chapters called another Kanda called Yajnavalki Kanda or Muni Kanda. And the last 2 chapters form what they call Khila Kanda. And this is how the 6 chapters are broadly divided into 3 Kandas or 3 sections. First is called Madhu Kanda, first 2 chapters, because the very famous Madhu Brahmana appears in here. And only one chapter is Madhu Kanda, and still the whole, all these 2 adhyayas are called Madhu Kanda, because it is said that the rest of the sections are also in developing the idea contained in Madhu Kanda, in support of that. And therefore, all these 2 adhyayas, first 2 adhyayas, are looked upon as the Madhu Kanda. The specialty of Brihadaranyaka Upanishad is that Shankaracharya has written a very elaborate bhashya on that. And it is said that all the Siddhantas of Vedanta are very well covered by Bhashyakara here. So he has sort of poured himself out in composing this bhashya. And that's why also it is looked upon as a very important Upanishad. Because all the various aspects that are found in the discussion of the Vedanta text are all to be found here. And this forms the source. And another important aspect about Brihadaranyaka Upanishad is that the disciple of Shankaracharya, that is Sureshwaracharya, who is also known as Vartikakara, has written a very elaborate Vartika, an elaborate explanation or exposition on the Bhashya in the verse form. So an exposition on the Bhashya in the verse form is called Vartika. Earlier also there used to be Vartikakara, and here of the Vyakarana. Here is a Vartikakara of the Upanishad. So he is known as Vartikakara Sureshwaracharya. who is known to be the direct disciple of Shankaracharya and one of the highly revered acharyas. His position or his status in the whole Vedanta Sampradaya is only next to Shankaracharya. And he himself is so great, and when he shows a great reverence for the teacher, that also shows the greatness of the teacher. So of course Shankaracharya does not need, of course, his greatness to be established by someone else. But even then it is significant that Sureshwaracharya, whose work proves him to be a very great acharya, also considers himself only like the dust at the feet of his teacher. And therefore, study of this Vartika of Sureshwaracharya also becomes a very important aspect of study of Shankara Bhashya. And Anandagiri has written, as usual, a commentary or a tika, or not a commentary really, but a tika, explanatory notes on the Shankara Bhashya. And in so doing, Anandagiri also has taken support of the Brihadaranyaka Vartika. It is also known as Brihadvartika. And therefore, the explanations given there and the views expressed by Vartikakara also form the basis of the tika of Anandagiri. Then finally, the text that we are the book that we are going to use as a text is the Kailasashram publication, where they have what we call the footnotes, which footnotes were dictated by a great teacher. His name was Govindananda. And this Swami Govindananda had his disciple Vishnudevananda. And Vishnudevananda wrote down all those footnotes over a number of years of study. And subsequently, Vishnudevananda himself also conducted an independent study with his disciples and again modified those footnotes, added where it was necessary. And thus we also have a body of what we call tippanis or elaborate footnotes upon the Bhashya as well as upon the Tika and even upon the mantras. And in this particular Upanishad, we find also that in the process of writing these tippanis or the footnotes, the Tippanikara also gives a reference of the Vartika. And therefore, now and then we'll find in a mention of a number of verses which are relevant from Brihadvartika. And so even footnote also is a very significant section of the study. In other Upanishads, the footnotes are not as elaborate as we find them in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. And therefore, our study will consist in the same pattern: Upanishad, then the Tika Bhashya, the Tika and the footnote. But the study starts the opposite way: the footnote and then Tika, then Bhashya and then Mantra. Because each one is an explanation of the previous one. And therefore, the footnote gives an explanation of the Tika gives an explanation of Bhashya, Bhashya gives an explanation of Mantra. And that is how the pattern of our study will be. Now, we start here because Bhashyakara himself explains the purpose, the Anubandha Chatushtaya and everything right to begin with in the Upanishad. And therefore, there is no need for us to have any separate introduction as far as the Upanishad is concerned. We can straight away start with the Mangala Acharana of Anandagiri on the page 1. Before that, there is a here also is a invocation by the Tippanikara. Yad Brahma Vishnu Shivarupa Taya Pratitam Srishti Sthiti Pralaya Karanatam Upayati Tad Brahma Nitya Nigamanta Padaika Vedyam Swante Svatas Phurdu Vastu Nirantaram Vaha. One word is added as Swante. Swante Svatas Phurdu Vastu Nirantaram Vaha. You found that in the footnote section. Swante means in my heart. Svadasphuratu, so may it shine on its own, because it's self-effulgent. The self, may it shine in my heart. Nirantaram vaha. Vaha swante nirantaram vastusphuratu. This vastu, this truth, may it always effortlessly shine in our heart. Tad Brahma, that Brahma is a vastu, is a truth of the reality. yad brahma vishnu shivarupataya pratitam, that param brahma which is pratitam, which is seen as brahma vishnu shiva, that brahma is brahma, vishnu and shiva. So that param brahma pratitam, which is perceived, which is experienced or seen as brahma, vishnu and mahesha, the creator, the sustainer and the resolver, the destroyer, pratitam. Srushti sthiti pralaya karanatam upayati. And therefore, it attains the status of karanata. Param Brahma also is called Jagat Karanam. Not because of itself, but on account of its creative power maya. Or when we look upon Param Brahma through the standpoint of the creation, then we call Param Brahma the Jagat Karanam. From the standpoint of Brahma, it is not Karanam because there is no Karyam. However, when we look upon Brahma through the Karya, which is the creation, then it is called Jagat Karanam. So, this Brahman has attained the state of Jagat Karanata or being the cause of the creation on account of its appearing as Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva. And therefore, it is called Srushti Karanam, Sthiti Karanam, Pralaya Karanam. Srushti Sthiti Pralaya Karanatam Upayati. So that which Upayati attains, Karanatam, the state of being the cause of the creation, sustenance and dissolution, Tad Brahma, Nitya Nigamanta Padaika Vedyam, Nigamanta, Nigam is Vedas, Nigamanta means Vedanta, Pada, Vedanta, Pada means the words or the statements of Vedanta, Eka Gamyam, Aupanishadam. So here of course this Mangalacharana has a reference to the theme that is going to be discussed in this Upanishad. And here in this Upanishad we find Param Brahma referred to as Aupanishadam Purusham or Aupanishadah Purushah. Upanishad Ek Gamyah Aupanishadah. And so it is said, Nitya Nigamanta Padaika Vedyam. Eka Vedyam, the one that can be known merely from the Nigamanta Pada, from the statements of the Vedanta. Svante svatasfurudu vastu nirantaram vaha. May that vastu param brahma, may it ever shine in our hearts. Nasmat kinchududeti nastamayate nasmin punaraliyate chinmatram paramarthatastu sakale jyotirmayam bhasate jati vyakti vivarjitam bahumatam sarvaprapanchatikam Svantadvantamatityatrashaminashamyanti tasmai namaha. Very beautiful. Tasmai namaha, to that Lord or to that Tattva, to that Truth, namaha, our salutations. Na asmat kinchududaiti, na astamayate, na asmin punarliyate. That from which nothing ever arises, nothing ever resolves, or nastamayate, nothing ever becomes, nothing merges into it. Meaning that from which really nothing has arisen, or nothing is sustained, or nothing really merges into, which is not primarily the cause of the creation. So when we look upon Brahman from the standpoint of creation, then we say that which appears as Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesha, and that which is called the Jagat Karanam. But when from the Brahman, from the standpoint of Brahman, nothing has arisen from it, nothing is sustained by it, nothing resolves back into it. What is it then? Chinmatram paramartha vastu sakale jyotirmayam bhasade or sakalam. Chinmatram paramartha vastu jyotirmayam bhasade. So that which jyotirmayam bhasade, that which of the nature of light or light of awareness. Chinmatram, which is pure awareness or consciousness. Paramartha tastu sakale jyotirmayam bhasate. So that which appears merely as awareness or as light, as illuminator, as avabhasaka, as sakshi. That's all it is. All it is nothing but the light of awareness or the light of knowledge, from which in reality nothing has arisen or nothing goes back into it or nothing merges into it. Jati vyakti vivarjitam. That which is devoid of these concepts of jati and vyakti. Jati means a species or a universal, and vyakti means a particular. Samanya and vishesha. jati and vyakti. So jati means a class and vyakti means a particular member of the class, like the cowness and the particular cow. So cowness will be called jati, a class of things, and a given cow will be called vyakti, a particular member of that class. You can say jati also is universal, representing the universal aspect of a thing, and vyakti is particular, denoting the particular aspect of a thing. Jati vyakti vivarjitam param brahma the atma, this chinmatram, this jyotihi, which is devoid of these concepts of jati and vyakti. There is no universality and particularity, because particular can be only with reference to universe, universal, and the idea of universal also is with reference to particular, that which is being just non-dual, and therefore even devoid of the ideas of universal and particular. So some people, when they meditate upon the self or Brahman, they try to meditate upon the universal, something that is common, but even that universal, that kind of thing also is not there.
Bahumatam sarva-prapancha-atigam,
sarva-prapancha-atigam. So atitya gacchati, that which transcends sarva-prapancha. So that which transcends the entire creation.
Svantadvantam atitya yatra shaminaha shamyandi.
Svantadvantam atitya, transcending their own mind, meaning transcending their own mind, yatra shaminaha shamyandi. Shaminaha shamyanti. Shamina means the quiet ones. People who have a mind which is totally abiding or resolved. Shamyanti. So those wise people or the yogis, shamyanti, they completely find a total peace or a total silence. So those people, those who become totally quiet, totally resolved or totally abiding, the people with abiding mind, completely resolved where Svantadvantamatitya, transcending their own mind. The idea is that Brahman is the very Sakshi. So here it is presented as the very self. So that which is jati vyakti vivarjitam, and that which is not even the jagat karanam, is in fact what? Nothing but the very witness, the very illuminator. And so the witness is the one that even transcends the mind, because it is the illuminator of the mind. So the Sakshi, the witness, is the one transcending the mind.
Svantadvantamatitya yatra shaminaha shamyanti tasmai namaha.
So that is ultimate abode, sakashta sa paragatihi, reaching where there is no return, reaching where there is no even a separate existence, there is no activity whatever. The idea is that some kind of an activity or even a semblance of activity can be there, as long as there is the idea of ahankara or individuality. The very ahankara itself is nothing but the activity in a condensed form, because it represents the potential of all the activity. And therefore, where the ahankara or the sense of individuality also is completely resolved. And therefore, where the wise people are completely resolved, sa kasta, sa paragatihi, that is the kasta, and that is the paragatihi. That is the culmination of everything, and that is the ultimate gati.
Pratasmarami hridi samsmradatma tattvam satchit sukam paramahamsa gatim turiyam.
So shaminaha is paramahamsa gatim. So that which is ultimate abode of the paramahamsa, tasmai namaha. To that namaha, my salutations.
Rajas tamas sattva gunavabhasini svatah pradipta chitireva shantida सदा भवद्भूत भविष्य भास्वतीं स्तवीमि शक्तिं चितिमेव केवलाम्.
अगेन द वे स्तवीमि शक्तिं चितिमेव केवलाम्, द चिति शक्ति, अगेन नथिंग बट दैट अवेयरनेस. इट इज कॉल्ड शक्ति बिकॉज इट इज अधिष्ठान आश्रय ऑफ द शक्ति. इट सेल्फ इज नॉट शक्ति रियली. चिति ही, चिति मीन्स अवेयरनेस, कॉल्ड चिति शक्ति. सो इट इज शक्ति एज अवेयरनेस. इट इज कॉल्ड शक्ति ऑफ द पावर ओनली बिकॉज it is the adhishthanam of all the power. That power, what we call maya, is brahmashraya maya. Brahma being the ashraya of maya, therefore Brahma also can be called shakti in some form. So chiti is called shakti in that sense.
Stavim shaktim chitimeva kevalam.
Kevala, kevala means non-dual, absolute or non-dual. that chiti or the awareness that is kevalam, non-dual, that chiti shakti or that power that is awareness, or that is the source of all the life, source of everything.
Rajas, tamas, sattva, guna, avabhasini.
This rajas, tamas and sattva, all these three gunas are there, avabhasini, that which illumines these three gunas. Svatah pradipta, that is self-shining.
Chitireva shantida.
This chitihi or the awareness, shantida. That only gives shanti. So that imparts us the shanti or the total silence. The shanti which is not even opposed to any noise, that kind of shanti. So naishtikim shanti. The ultimate peace is what is given by this chiti.
Sada bhavat bhuta bhavishya bhaswadim stavi mishaktim.
That bhavat bhuta bhavishya bhaswadim, that which illumines also all the three periods of time. And therefore that which is again beyond the three periods of time, that illumines the three gunas, and therefore that which is beyond the three gunas, and that chiti or the awareness is shantida, is the bestower of all the shanti or all the peace and silence. And that is also the source of the entire creation.
Stami stavimi, that I salute, I prostrate or I worship that chiti shakti.
And this is how the Vidya Vachaspati Swami Vishnu Devananda. So Vishnu Devananda ji, who was the Acharya in Kailas Ashram, who has written this tippani, his invocation. Then we go up to the invocation of Anandagiri.
Yavidya vashad vishvam drushyate rashanahivat yad vidyaya chitadhanihi tam vande purushottamam. Yad avidyaya vashad vishvam drushyate rashanahivat
yad avidyaya vashad yasya avidyaya vashad. On account of avidya or ignorance of which, or ignorance of whom, vishvam drushyate, the whole creation is seen. Rashana ahivat. Rashana means rope.
Rashana katisutram mekhala aparapariyaya.
Katisutram. You know that the string or the cord that they tie on the kati. So whenever there is this ceremony of upanayana, then kati mekhala, either made of munja or made of some material, is tied around the kati pradesha. So that is called Rashana. Rashana also means a rope in this case. So Rashana Ahivat. Ahi means a snake. So Rashana Ahivat, like a snake on the rope. Yet Avidya, on account of the Avidya or the ignorance of the rope, the snake shines on account of the ignorance of the rope. Otherwise, the snake would not be seen. So snake is perceived, or the snake is seen only on account of what? The ignorance of the rope. If the rope were seen as rope in the broad daylight, nobody would have seen a snake there. And similarly also the whole creation appears. Because of what? Because of ignorance of whom?
Yat avidya vashad vishvam drushyate rashanahivat.
Yat vidya jitad hanihi. And the snake hanihi is completely removed or destroyed, just as the snake is completely destroyed by the knowledge of the rope, and so also by the knowledge of whom? By knowledge of which Lord, or Paramatma, the whole creation is destroyed. At least it loses its duality. Even if you continue to perceive the creation, the reality is gone. So that the knowledge, by the knowledge of which, the creation loses its reality. Like the mirage water continues to shine in spite of knowing it as mirage water, but it loses its waterness. It is no more real. And so also the creation, even when it is perceived after the knowledge, it loses its reality. In that sense it is said, yad vidyaj tadhanihi. So tadhani means vishvahanihi. So the creation is destroyed because of the vidya or the knowledge of which, or knowledge of whom? Tam vande purushottamam. Tam purushottamam vande. Uttamam purusham. Sharaf purusha, Aksharaf Purusha and Purushottama. So Akshara Purusha is this changing creation. Akshara Purusha is the cause which is immutable in a relative sense. And Purushottama is the one that is beyond both and which is even the adhishthanam for both Kshara and Akshara Purushaha. Tam Vande. So that Purushottama, the ultimate Lord, I salute.
Namastrayanta Sandoha Sarasiruha Bhanave Gurave Parapakshauga Dhanda Dhamsa Patiyase.
Having saluted the Lord Param Brahma, now the Tikakara offers the salutations to the Guru.
Namastrayanta. The fourth footnote. Trayanta Sandoha. Sandoha means Samuha.
Trayi means the Vedas. So often the Vedas are known as Trayi. The Rug Veda, Yajur Veda and Sama Veda. The group of these three Vedas is known as Trayi. So Trayanta means Vedanta.
So Namastrayanta Sandoha Sarasiruha Bhanave.
Sandoha means a Samuha. So Vedanta Samuha, this body of knowledge is known as Vedanta. And that body of knowledge, namely Vedanta, is compared to Sarasiruha, is compared to a lotus. And who is my teacher? My teacher is like the Bhanu, like the sun, for the lotus of Vedanta. Because even as the sun arises, how the lotus slowly and slowly blooms. So this Sarasiruha, Saras means this Sarovara. So that which arises or that which grows in a lake is called Sarasiruha. And this lotus, it just blooms when the sun rises. In the presence of the sun, the lotus blooms. And so also the lotus of Vedanta blooms in the presence of whom? So therefore is compared, the teacher is compared to the very sun in the presence of whom the lotus of Vedanta just blooms.
Namaha, to whom my salutations? Gurave, to the Guru. And who is he? Parapakshauga dhvanta dhvamsapatiyase.
Then this Guru also is a little bit of a combating Guru, you know. Not only, so lotus of Vedanta shines, but then what happens is, two things happen. Certain kinds of lily, this lily actually will close when the sun shines and the lotus blooms. And so two things happens. As the sun even arises, the lotus is bloom and the lilies all close. So all the Parapaksha, all the Purupakshis, they are like the lilies which just close, you know, completely in the presence of the sun, my teacher. So Parapaksha, Parapaksha means Purupaksha. Parapaksha Augha, this Augha. So Augha means a whole samuh, the whole host of these Purupakshas.
Dhvanta Dhvamsa Patiyase.
So Dhvanta means the darkness. The darkness in the of the nature of all these body or this host of Purupakshas, the Bhanu is, you know. So because he is a sun, so nicely it has been said. So not only in the presence of sun, the lotus is bloom, but the darkness is completely eliminated, removed. So in the presence of the sun, who is my teacher, the darkness is completely dispelled. What kind of darkness? When the lotus of the Vedanta blooms, the darkness of the nature of this host of all the Purupakshis, who have created a lot of confusion. The Purupakshis create lots of doubts and lot of confusions in our mind, and that is nothing but ignorance. Because the samshaya, viparyaya, all of these are the products of ignorance. And therefore, ignorance of the nature of samshaya and the viparyaya, which is created by this host of all the Purupakshis, that darkness is completely dispelled by which? Sun. To that sun, my teacher, Samaha Namaskar. That must be his teacher or it must be Bhagavad Pada. Then the teacher, Bhashyakara.
Bhagavat Pada Padabja Dvandvam Dvandvanibarhanam Sureshwaradi Sadbhrungaihi Avalambitam Abhaje.
Sixth footnote. Parapakshaugaha Bhedavadi Samuhaha. Okay, I should have read that. So, Bhedavadi is this host of Bhedavadis. Of Purupakshis mainly, who are in this Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, again you'll find again and again the Purupakshis like Bhartru Prapancha. We talked about him in the Naishkarma Siddhi. But Bhartru Prapancha here with a Bheda Bhedavadi. And therefore, Bhedavadi. Moment in a Bheda, you add something, it is only Bheda. So Vishishta Advaita is only Dvaita. Moment you qualify Advaita, it becomes Dvaita only. That's why the so-called Shankara Sampradaya is known as Kevala Dvaita. mean Advaita, which they call it Shankara Sampradaya, but it is only Vedanta Sampradaya. It's called Kevala Advaita because Advaita that does not admit of any kind of, not even a trace of duality. And they add little qualification, then it's called Vishishta Advaita, Bheda Bheda, etc. So Bhartru Prapancha and others who are repeatedly mentioned here, and opinions of whose opinions are taken up for discussions and refuted. So these Bhedavadis, that Samuha, the darkness of the nature of these Bhedavadis is completely dispelled. And then six footnotes it, bhaje, samantad bhaje. So bhaje means I worship him in every way. All inclusive, Shraddha Bhakti Udrekena Ityartha. So to this Bhashyakara, Bhagavat Pada is usually even so. Shruti Smriti Purana Nam Alayam Karunalayam Namami Bhagavat Pada. So that's why Bhagavat Pada is Shankaracharya. And very often Shankaracharya is referred to as Bhagavat Pada. That was the name. So Govinda Pada and Bhagavat Pada, Padma Pada, or Gauda Pada, Govinda Pada, Bhagavat Pada, Padma Pada. This is a tradition, you know. So Bhagavat Pada, Pada Abja Dvandvam. Okay, Abhaje means I worship with all the Shraddha and Bhakti. Udreka. Udreka means the Shraddha and the Bhakti are overflowing. So with an overflowing Shraddha and the Bhakti, I worship Bhagavat Pada, Shankaracharya. Bhagavat Pada, Pada Abja Dvandvam Abhaje. I worship the lotus feet of the Lord or my teacher Bhagavat Pada. And what is the specialty of that Pada Dvandvam or the pair of lotus feet? Dvandva Nibarhanam. That pair of lotus feet or these two lotus feet, Dvandva Nibarhanam, which completely destroys the Dvandva or the duality. So this lotus feet which completely destroys the duality, this pair of lotus feet of Shankaracharya I worship with all Shraddha and Bhakti. And lotus always is surrounded by the honeybees or the Brahmaras. So this lotus of the nature of the pair of feet of Bhagavat Pada is also all the time surrounded by the Bhrunga or the Brahmara or this big black honeybees of the nature of Sureshwaradi. So Sureshwara becomes a Bhrunga who all the time does the sevanam of the lotus feet of Bhagavat Pada. Sureshwaradi, beginning from Sureshwara and all the teachers. So hundreds of teachers who have contributed to this tradition of Vedanta, and all of whom derive their inspiration from the Bhashya. So all the teachers of Vedanta, directly or indirectly, invariably derive their inspiration from Shankara Bhashya. And therefore, all the time they are only around, you know, the lotus feet of of Shankaracharya. So Sureshwadi Sadbhrungaihi. Sadbhrunga. There are many Bhrungas, other Bhrungas also, which must be perhaps hovering around other lotuses. But Sadbhrunga, the Bhrunga or these honeybees which are really have the right intellect or right mind, so they always are around the lotus feet of whom to this Bhagavat Pada or to this lotus feet or the pair of lotus feet of Bhagavat Pada Abhaje I worship. So earlier Guru himself was saluted. Now the lotus feet of the teacher are saluted. And also, even Anandagiri sees it necessary to even salute the Vartikakara or Sureshwaracharya. Bruhadaranyake Bhashye Shishyopa Kruti Siddhaye Sureshwaroktimashritya Kriyate Nyaya Niranaya. So Nyaya Niranaya Kriyate. This particular tika is known as Nyaya Niranaya. Where the Nyaya is, there is an ascertainment of the Tatpara Nishaya of with the help of the Nyaya. So the word Nyaya Niranaya is explained in the footnote number 8. Number 7 rather, Upakrutihi Asambhavana Viparidhavana Rahityena Vakyartha Bodhrupa Upakrutihi Grahya. So Shishyopakruti Siddhaye. for accomplishment of upakriti. Upakara means for benevolence or for favoring the disciples. So this favor of the benevolence is in what form? In the form of vakyartha bodha rupa. In the form of the bodha or the unfoldment of the teaching or revealing the vakyartha. Vakya means mahavakya. Aham, brahmasmi and others. So this vakyartha bodha for the knowledge of the artha or the meaning of the mahavakya. And how is the meaning or the knowledge of the mahavakya being imparted? So this tika, Anandagiri says, which I am composing, the purpose of the tika is to make the disciples see the meaning of this mahavakya. And how do they see the meaning? Asambhavana, viparita bhavana, rahityena. So asambhavana, samshaya bhavana, viparita bhavana. So of course, the manana and nididhyasana, that will be the purpose of this tika. Asambhavana here, or all the samshayas, and all the viparita means all the false notions which are there. So by removal of all the doubts, upakara, that's the nature of the favor that this tika is expected to do. That's the purpose of this tika. Shishya upakriti siddhe, of course. For whom? Shishya means the disciples. For that purpose, nyaya nirnaya kriyate. What is nyaya nirnaya? Say, shrutyarthopad balakataya. So, upod balakataya bhashyoktanam yuktinam nirnaya. Vadishankita abhasata nirakarana purasaram abhilashita arthasadagatva vyavasthapana ityarthaha. So, nyaya nirnaya. So, nyayanam nirnaya, nyaya nirnaya. So, there are various nyayas. So, various yuktis are there in the Bhashya. So, when Bhashyakara writes commentary or exposition upon this Upanishad, then there is nyaya or various yuktis, or various arguments or logical reasons are provided. And nirnaya, to ascertain the meaning of the nyaya or this the logical, you know, the exposition that Bhashyakara has given. By what? Shrutyarthopad balakataya. So upod balaka means confirming. Shrutyartha upod balakataya. By way of confirming the shrutyartha, by way of confirming the artha or the purport of the shruti or the Upanishads here. Bhashyoktanam yuktinam. Nyayanam means bhashyoktanam yuktinam. The yuktis or the arguments or the reasons that are given in the Bhashya. And what is the nature of those yuktis? In order to confirm the meaning of the Upanishad. So Bhashyakara has given a number of yuktis in keeping with the vision of the Upanishads or to confirm and verify the vision of the Upanishads. So these yuktis are given in the Bhashya. Tesham nirnaya. Nirna means to arrive at the ascertained meaning of these yuktis. How? Vadishankita abhasata nirakarana purasaram. So vadishankita abhasa. The many purvavadis or purvapakshis actually also give different meanings of the Upanishad vakyas. So Upanishad vakyas also have been interpreted by other teachers. And so this Bhartru Prapancha and all of these people must be very influential at the time of Bhashyakara. The fact that in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, Bhashyakara has taken real time to again and again mention the opinion of Bhartru Prapancha with Bheda Bhedavada and therefore Gnana Karma Samuchya, that this opinion is mentioned again and again because Bhartru Prapancha was very influential at that time. And Bhartru Prapancha and others have given commentary or written commentaries upon the Upanishad and have brought out some different kinds of meanings of the Upanishad Vakyas, which is what we call the Abhasa. So they also provide the Yuktis, but they are not the real Yuktis, only the appearance of the Yuktis. So Vadishankita Abhasata Nirakarana Purasaram. So, or Vadishankita Abhasata, that's another way, that many Vadis or the many opponents think that Shankaracharya, the Yukti that Shankaracharya has provided, are not the real yuktis, but they are the abhasas. So, vadishankita abhasata. So Vadis means all the Puravadis think that Shankaracharya has given the Yuktis to explain the Upanishad, but those Yuktis are not the real Yuktis, but they are just the Abhas of the Yuktis in order to simply emphasize his own opinions. Very often Shankaracharya also is misinterpreted like this, that in order to just project his own opinion, he seems to perhaps twist the meaning of the Upanishad also. And therefore, they think that some of the yuktis or the reasoning that Shankaracharya has provided are not the real yuktis but abhasa. So, Anandagiri has to show that how the yuktis or the reasonings provided by Shankaracharya are true. And therefore, whatever doubts that the other vadis, means other opponents, may have created pertaining to the explanation of Shankaracharya, those doubts all must be removed in order to really make this bhashya free of any kind of doubts or free of any kind of defects. So the purpose of the Tika of Anandagiri is not only to explain the bhashya, but also to release the bhashya from any kind of doubts or any kind of charges that other people may have made, doubting the very purpose of the bhashya also. Either creating confusion about the meaning of the bhashya vakya or bhashya yukti, or questioning the very intention of Bhashyakar also. And therefore, by resolving all of these things, we are going to ascertain the meaning of the yuktis of the Bhashya. And that is how the Bhashya will be clarified. Therefore, the Bhashya meaning will be made completely clear for the disciples, so that they can have the bodha or the knowledge of the Vedanta Mahavakya. And how did you accomplish that? Sureshwaroktim Ashritya. For that Anandagiri says, I had to take also the support of the very same task done by Sureshwaracharya in the Vartika. So Sureshwaracharya, the disciple of Shankaracharya, has written very elaborate, some 12,000 verses have been written on the Brihadaranyaka Bhashya. And the yuktis provided there, or the explanations provided in this Vartika, form the basis of explanation that I am providing of the Shankara Bhashya. In that manner, this Tika also will help clarify the meaning of Bhashya, and therefore clarify the meaning of the Mahavakya, and that is how create the knowledge in the disciples. And that is how the Tika will become the Upakaraka, will also become the helpful means for the knowledge in the disciples. This is how Anandagiri writes his invocation. Then we go to the Bhashyakara invocation. So Bhashyakara also begins with his prayer or invocation, salutation. So we read the Bhashya here. Om Namo Brahmadibhyah. Brahma Vidya Sampradaya Kartrubhyah. Vamsha Rushibhyah. Namo Gurubhyah. Namo Gurubhyah. Salutations to the teachers. Brahmadibhyah. Beginning from Brahmaji. Brahma Vidya Sampradaya Kartrubhyah. So those people who have propagated the Sampradaya or the tradition of Brahma Vidya. Sampradaya Kartrubhyah, not Brahma Vidya Kartrubhyah. So all the teachers in the form of the various rishis and the acharyas who are all members of the sampradaya, the very tradition of Vedanta, and who therefore have been responsible for the continuation as well as for the enrichment as well as of the continuation. So these teachers of Vedanta have not only continued the tradition of teaching, but have enriched the tradition of teaching also, and they are called Sampradaya Kartrus. So they are the Kartas or the promulgators of the Sampradaya or this Vedanta tradition. Vamsha Rushibhyah. So all the Rushis are Vamsha. Says Vamsha Rushibhyah. So is Acharya, Vamsha Acharya Paramparaya Upadesha Iti Yavada. Vamsha means lineage. So here there is a whole lineage. And what is the nature of lineage? So here there are, as you said, there are two paramparas are there, Bindu parampara and Nada parampara. And so the father-son parampara is a Bindu parampara. And the teacher-disciple parampara is Nada parampara. And therefore also we have a whole lineage of the teacher and the disciple, that is called Vamsha. Acharya paramparaya upadeshaha. And therefore, the same upadesha is passed on from the teacher to the disciple, like the one lamp lighting the other lamp. And so also, the one teacher passing on the same knowledge to the disciple. And the process, enriching that process also, enriching that tradition as well. Because if the Upanishad itself is nothing but this format of teaching from the teacher to the disciple. And you find that every Upanishad also has its unique features. Inasmuch as every disciple also is different, and teacher also in that sense, by way of personality is different, and the conditions or situations in which this teaching or the dialogue takes place also are different, and therefore different teachers also employ different prakriyas, so different models, different methods, different ways of communications employ. The truth that is communicated is the same, and therefore there is no question about that. But the mode of communication keeps on getting enriched and keeps on getting modified, depending on the time, depending on the questions that are facing the disciples, and depending on the various doubts and things that are to be raised, depending on the Purapakshins existing at that time. And that is how every teacher has to deal with this. And that's how the whole sampradaya gets further and further enriched. So Vamsha Rushibhyam. This Vamsha Rushi, you'll find here in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, as you said, there are three kandas, Madhukanda, Munikanda and Khilakanda. Each kanda consisting of two chapters, and every adhyaya has number of sub chapters which are called brahmanas. So first, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. So prathama adhyaya is, for example, six brahmana. Brahmana means a chapter. So adhyaya, if it is called one portion, then brahmana will be called a chapter. So last brahmana of each kanda. So last brahmana each kanda means the last brahmana of the second adhyaya, fourth adhyaya and the sixth adhyaya, all of them have a whole description of the vamsha, or the lineage of the teacher and the disciple. These names are given. And they are all called vamsha rushaya. All of them are the vamsha rushis. So those rushis are the teachers who are members of this Vedanta tradition and who have continued this parampara, and because of whom this teaching comes down to us, to all these Vamsha Rishis, Namo Gurubhyaya, and to our own teachers also, our salutations. Now Anandagiri gives an explanation of this prayer also. Says on the page 2, Kandvopanishad Vivarana Vyajena Asheshaam Asheshaam Evopanishadam Shodhayudu Kamaha Bhagavan Bhashyakaraha Vignopashamadi Samartam Shishtachara Pramanakam Parapara Guru Namaskara Rupam Mangalam Acharati Om Namo Brahmadi Bhyayati. Well, which we should have read first actually, according to our system. So, Kandvopanishad Vivarana Vyajena. Kandvopanishad, footnote number 4. Kanva Shakhiyo Upanishad Ityartha Bhashyakariya Hiyam Shaka. So it is thought that this Bhashyakara, so everyone belongs to some Veda or the other, some branch of the Veda. So Bhashyakara belong to Yajurveda. In the south, Yajurveda is more prevalent. Of that also, Bhashyakara must have belonged to the Shukla Yajurveda rather than Krishna Yajurveda. And in Shukla Yajurveda also, we should have mentioned, there are two recensions, Kandva and Madhyandini. That we mentioned in course of our discussion of the Ishavasya Upanishad, that Shukla Yajurveda also has Kandva and Madhyandini, of which Madhyandini is generally prevalent in North India and Kandva is prevalent in South India. So even when you listen to the recitation of Shukla Yajurveda in the South India, it will be different from the Shukla Yajurveda recitation in North India. So every time somebody points out to me, see, this is the way to chant, you know, because he thinks that this is all wrongly chanted, you know, in the North India. I said, Swami, this is Karnava Shaka. There is Madhyandini Shaka, you know. Says, no, no, Madhyandini Shaka also is different, you know. But anyway, so Madhyandini Shaka is in the North India and Karma Shaka in South India. And it is believed that Acharya himself belonged to the Karma Shaka of the Shukla Yajurveda. And therefore also the such elaborate exposition of this Upanishad. So, well, we don't want to dwell into that, but everybody gives a validity to the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad Bhashya without any question. So those who have questions about what is composed by Shankaracharya and what is not, etc., you know, you can doubt everything and anything. But as far as the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad Bhashya is concerned, there is no question that it is the composition of Shankaracharya. Therefore also it is a very unique and very important place in the Vedantic tradition. The study of Vedanta would not be complete unless, of course, Shankara Bhashya is studied, and unless the Brihadaranyaka Shankara Bhashya is studied, it would not be complete. It would bring up so many different aspects for discussion. And so, Karnva Upanishad Vivarana Vyajena, by way of the Vivarana or the exposition of this Karnva Shakya Upanishad, which is the Brihadaranyaka, there is another reading of Brihadaranyaka, which is according to Madhyandini, which also is essentially similar, but then there are mantra Bhata Vedas now and then, and Shankaracharya has chosen to write commentary on the Karnva Shaka. In the Ishavasya also, the Ishavasya Upanishad also, the Karnva reading of Ishavasya is what is commented upon by Acharya, and Brihadaranyaka also. Asheshameva Upanishadam Shodhaitu Kamaha. So Karnva Shakya, but as far as Madhyandini also is included here. So even though Bhashyakara directly seems to write an exposition of the Upanishad of Karnva Shakya, but then whatever is there in Madhyandini, which may not have been included here, or where there may have been variations between Karnva and Madhyandini, they are also included in the Bhashya. So Asheshameva Upanishadam Shodhaitu Kamaha. Asheshama Upanishadam, complete Upanishad. Shodhaitu Kamaha. Shodhanam means a deliberation. So one who is desirous of the deliberation upon the entire Upanishad. So Nirnita Tatparikaha Kartumanaha Ityartha. So one who is interested, whose purpose is to ascertain the Tatpari, the purport of the entire Upanishad. Bhagavan Bhashyakaraha Vighnopa Shamadi Samartham Shishtachara Pramanakam Parapara Guru Namaskarupam Mangalam Acharati. Bhagavan Bhashyakara Mangalam Acharati. So Mangalacharanam Karoti. Here there is a Mangalacharanam, invocation. Mangalacharanam means invocation. What are the nature, different kinds of invocations are there? In what kind of category this invocation fits? Parapara Guru Namaskarupam. Otherwise sometimes it is Tattvanusandhanam. Sometimes there is the prayers, and sometimes also the anusandhana of the Guru. So these different ways are there to invoke the grace of the Lord. So Guru also is nothing but none other than the Lord. So whether you invoke the Guru, or whether you invoke the Lord, or whether you, so that is how it is, or you pray to the Lord, or you just remember Him, it's all the same thing. So here, Param Brahma or Paramatma is remembered. Ultimately, the one from whom the grace comes is only the Lord. Whether through the Guru or in the form of Guru, the Lord may shower His grace through the Guru or in the form of Tasmai Shri Guru Murtaye Namaidam Sri Dakshinam, in the form of Guru also. So, by saluting the teachers, in fact, Acharya seeks to salute the Lord.
Bhagavan Bhashyakaraha Mangalamacharati Parapara Guru Namaskar Rupam
Para and Apara. So immediate and remote. So Apara Guru is immediate Guru. Para Guru is remote Guru. So the own teacher as well as the earlier teachers. So salutation of to the teachers himself, the direct teacher as well as to the earlier teacher. What is Mangala? What is the nature of Mangalacharam?
Shishtachara Pramanakam.
So Mangalacharya means for the sake of Bhashyakara also that he remembers the teacher and therefore remembers the Lord and seeks the grace. At the same time,
Somebody may say that there is no need for someone like Bhashyakara to mention it openly. He can do it in his mind also. So, Acharya can just remember it in his mind and without having to write a statement about it. So, what's the need to express it in words?
Shishta Achara Pramanakam.
They're all the Shishta. All the learned people and all the people who are in the tradition, all of them always invoke the grace of the Lord. So, Shishtacharam is Shishtanam Acharaha. So, all the Shishtas, all the right good people always do the invocation. And therefore, Shishtachara Pramanakam. So, Shishtacharaha Pramanam is said that Shishtachara Pramanakam. So, Mangalam. So, that word is Shishtachara is a Pramanam. Or which also gives Pramanya Shishtachara in that sense. That when Acharya does it, then we also understand that this is what one should do. So Acharya does it because the sister Purushas do. As well, he himself being the sister Purusha, when he does it, then also this Mangalacharanam, this tradition also gets its Pramanyam, that this is what we should do. So Shishtachara, in order to sustain the Shishtachara, and Vigno Pashamadi Samartham, and that Mangalam, or the invocation, Samartham, which is capable of Vigna Upashama, which is capable of removal of all the obstacles. So it is necessary to seek the grace of Lord in order that obstacles are removed on our path for the study. In case of Bhashyakara, the obstacles in the form of perhaps composing this Bhashya. In our case, obstacles in the form whatever may be there, to which may become an obstacle to Adhyatmika, Adhi Bhautika or Adhi Devika. Three forms of obstacles can be. So, Adhidaivika, even the Daiva also may not be in favor, Graha may not be in favor. All kinds of difficulties may be created, and therefore, in spite of all our best intentions, we just may not be able to attend the classes or do the Swadhyaya. Adi Bhautika, the Bhutas may not be favorable. Like the scooters and the motor cars and all kinds of things, they may just go out of order at that time, rickshaws may not be there. And that's how this Bhuta, the elements around also may not be favorable. Or Adhyatmika. Our own body may not be favorable, our own mind also may not be favorable. Sometimes it happens that our own body, our own mind, our own personality also creates an obstacle. And therefore, it is very necessary. It's a great grace. I mean, we must consider ourselves extremely blessed. There is no way to express the blessing that we are enjoying here, that we are able to study this. And that itself is a result. I mean, we need not seek any other end also. To do this itself is a great blessing, and no further blessing also is needed. And that we have been able to do all this time itself shows how we are enjoying the grace of the teachers and the Lord, and we continue to seek the grace so that our Swadhyaya continues. So Vigno Pashamadi Samartham, this Mangalam, this invocation, which is capable or which has the strength of dispelling all the obstacles. Bhagavan Bhashyakara Mangalam Acharati. Bhagavan Bhashyakara, he makes this invocation, Om Namo Brahmadibhyaiti. So Namaha Brahmadibhya. Beginning from Brahma. What's the meaning of the word Brahma? Says Anandagiri, Vedaha Hiranyagarbhova Brahma. So Brahma can mean, Brahma has various meanings. Param Brahma, of course, or Hiranyagarbha Brahmaji, the creator, or in Veda also. So Vedo Hiranyagarbhova Brahma. By word Brahma, maybe Bhashyakara means Vedas. Namo Brahmadibhya, this whole tradition or the teachers which are originated from Vedas themselves, or Hiranyagarbhadibhya, the first teacher is Brahmaji. Brahmadevanam prathamasambhuva Vishvasya karta bhuvanasya gopta sab brahma vidyam sar vidya pradishtam atharvaya jesh putraya praha atharvanayam pravadeta vidyam. This is how the tradition begins, from Brahmaji to Atharva and to all the rishis, coming down to our own teacher. So Brahmadibhya, this whole lineage of the teachers, the whole sampradaya, which begins from Brahmaji, from the creator himself, Hiranyagarbha. Tan namaskarena sarvaha devataha namaskrutaha bhavanti. Just by saluting Brahmaji or saluting Vedas, sarvaha devataha namaskrutaha bhavanti. All the devatas also get saluted in the very process.
So you need not offer salutation separately. So Tulsidas ji in his Ramcharitmanas has invoked so many people, you know, so many devatas and so many other aspects, including Ayodhya and all the four brothers. And so then all the devatas finally also invokes. So how many devatas? There are 33 crore devatas. Is he going to invoke every devata and offer his salutation? He says, one salutation I am offering to all the devatas. So when all the devatas are there in line, offer one salutation that applies to all of them. And similarly also, offer salutation to Brahma, Hiranyagarbha, and all the devatas get included. Or offer salutation to the Vedas, all the devatas get included. Why do they get included? Tadarthatvat, tadatmakatvaccha. Tadarthatvat, footnote number 7. Tadarthatvat is Veda Pratipadyatvat ityartha. So when Brahma means Veda, then tadarthatvat means what? Vedarthatvat. Veda Pratipadyatvat, because all the devatas are Veda Pratipadya. So devatas who are revealed by the Vedas. So all the devatas are revealed by the Vedas, and therefore, or to reveal them, or to explain them, or to give them the teaching, so is the purpose of the Vedas. Therefore, tadarthatvat. And then subsequently says, tadatmakatvacha. Where the word Brahma means Hiranyagarbha, then tadatmakatvacha. Hiranyagarbha is the soul, the atma of all the devatas. So Brahma means Vedas, they reveal the nature of all the devatas. If Brahma means Hiranyagarbha, then Hiranyagarbha is the atma or the self of all the devatas. How is it so? The footnote continues. Eshahu ityadi vakyataha. Okay, himself, Anandagiri himself says, Eshahu yeva sarve devaha iti shrutehe. Footnote number 8. Right. So, footnote number 7 also mentions it. So that should be called footnote number 8 in that case. So Eshahu is the footnote number 8, and therefore the third line should be looked upon as, I guess, footnote number 8. Well, anyway, footnote number 8 says Brihadaranyaka Upanishad 146. So this mantra is taken from this very same Upanishad here. It says Eshahu ityadi vakyatah avyavahita purvam etasya eva va visrushti iti vakyam. Etasya etasya sa visrushtihi eshahu eva sarve devaha. This is the vakya in this particular, in the first chapter, fourth brahmana, sixth mantra. And then the tippani explains there, etasya eva sa visrushtihi iti vakyam. So avyavahita purvam, immediately preceding eshahu eva sarve devaha, is the vakya. Etasyevasa visrushtihi. In the vakyam, tathacha, to explain this, ya visrushtihi vividha agnyadirupena devanam srushtihi. Visrushti means vividha srushtihi. This variegated creation. In the form of what? Agnyadirupena devanam srushtihi. This creation of all the devatas beginning from Agni. So all the devatas, that's how the whole description is given there. So creation of all the devatas beginning from Agni. Sa etasya prajapate heva eva bhedaha. All these devatas, all this srushti or the vivida srushti in the form of the devatas, in nothing but this prajapati himself. Prajapati himself became all the devatas. So from the prajapati it came, and prajapati himself became all the devatas, and therefore prajapati of Hiranyagarbha is the self of all the devatas. He himself is all the devatas. That is what is said in the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. So eshahu eva sarve devaha. This Prajapati himself is all the devatas. It is Shrutehe. And therefore, by salutation to Brahma or Prajapati or Hiranyagarbha, all the devatas are also saluted, because he is nothing but all the devatas. And also by saluting Brahma, which is Veda, also all the devatas get saluted, because the Vedas reveal all the devatas. And then in this manner, all the devatas are saluted here. ब्रह्मादिभ्यः आदिपदेन परमेष्ठि प्रभृतः गृह्यन्ते. परमेष्ठि आल्सो इज ब्रह्मा जी, बट हियर परमेष्ठि इज इंटरप्रेटेड एज विराट. फुटनोट नंबर 9. परमेष्ठि मींस विराट. सो हिरण्यगर्भ, विराट एंड ऑल दीस अदर देवतास आल्सो आर सैल्यूटेड हियर. Adipadena Parameshti Prabhutaya Grihyante.
So why do you have to think that, why Adi is necessary? On one hand you say that Hiranyagarbha includes all the devatas, and beginning from Hiranyagarbha, there is nothing other than Hiranyagarbha, all the devatas are none other than Hiranyagarbha, then you need not say devatas beginning from Hiranyagarbha. You will say devatas beginning from Hiranyagarbha if those other devatas are different from Hiranyagarbha. But if all the devatas were Hiranyagarbha, then where is the question of devatas beginning from Hiranyagarbha? And still it is said that, or Hiranyagarbha included, etc. You know, why? There is none other than Hiranyagarbha.
Yadyapi tesham muktaha brahmantra bhavaha.
Even though Virat and all the devatas are included in Hiranyagarbha,
tathapi teshu anadara nirasartham prutagrahanam.
Even then, perhaps, even though it is our intention that all the devatas are saluted when we salute Brahmaji, but maybe some other devatas may feel neglected. So, anadara nirasartham, that we do not disrespect them. By respecting Hiranyagarbha, all the devatas are respected, and still, just in order to avoid any chance of disrespect to any other devatas, Prithakgrahanam, Adi means this other, Adi means Virat, this Prithakgrahanam is separately also taken here. This is a Nyaya, that is called Brahmana Parivrajaka Nyaya. So, they say that call five Brahmanas and also call that Parivrajaka. Parivrajaka means a mendicant or a sannyasi. And a sannyasi generally is a Brahmana. So when all Brahmanas include call for, then sannyasi also is included because he is also a Brahmana. But since he enjoys the status of his own, in order to, then he is separately mentioned. Separately mentioned in order to show that he has a certain distinction. So even though Brahmana includes him, and still he is mentioned just to show an extra respect. So bring everybody and bring him also. So everybody includes that person, and still make sure that he is included to show a separate or special respect. And so also, even though Hiranyagarbha includes all the devatas, Virat and other devatas are mentioned here in order to show a respect towards them also.
Namaha Brahmadibhyah,
that is supposed to be Chaturthi. Not Panchami or whatever, Tritiya, but Chaturthi,
Namo Yoge, because Namaha always governs the Chaturthi. Namashabdah Trivida Prakhvi Bhava Vishayah.
So three ways, Manasa, Vachasa, Kayena. So by the mind and by the words and by the body we salute. So salutation always includes the body as well as the Vani. Ashtanga includes the body as well as the words as well as the mind. And therefore in all the threefold ways we are offering our salutation Namaha. See, when you salute somebody, then you are accepting a lower position. So apakarsha. Whoever you salute to, his utkarsha, that he is exalted and I am inferior, and the one I am saluting to is superior. So this is the purpose of prahvi bhava. And this is a big problem with people. In the West, you ask them to salute, they can't do that. Why should I salute? Salutation means that I'm lower and he's higher. How can it be? There's nobody higher and nobody lower. Everybody is equal. But not so in India. Our own children also have this. They are brought up in the Western culture. And therefore, they don't think there is any superior. That we are, just because I'm small in age doesn't mean that I'm inferior. Somebody is more in age doesn't mean that he's superior. Or somebody is more learned. So because of anything, nobody becomes superior. That's all. And therefore, there is no reverence there. Everybody is okay. Hi Tom and hi Bob and whatever it is. Everybody is same. Whether it's the president of the company or whoever it is. And therefore, it is, in a way, it is good also for their own self-image. At the same time, because of a total lack of reverence, they also do not command that favor. So reverence, when they are expressed, you always also invoke the favor of a person. And that favor, of course, or we think that favor can be done only when such a thing is done, of course. Maybe they are able to express favor without that, you know. whatever. Our tradition is that we invoke the favor by salutation, by placing that person at a higher pedestal, and by also declaring loudly that I am at a lower pedestal. And so, so apakarsha bodhanukula vyapara, any vyapara, anything that is done, any activity that is done, that shows that I am inferior and you are superior, that will be called prahvi bhava. Prahvi bhava means, so bowing down, and that is done at the physical level, at the level of the speech, at the level of mind. So namah shabda trivida prahvi bhava vishaya. Namo brahmadibhya, that means that I salute all the devatas, beginning from Brahmaji, with my body, mind and the speech. Nanu brahma vidyam vaktu kamena kimiti ete namaskriyante. Bhashyakara is brahma vidyam vaktu kamaha. One who is desirous of exposing brahma vidya, expounding brahma vidya. Kimiti ete namaskriyante. Instead of saluting brahma vidya, how come Bhashyakara salutes the rishis? If the intention is to expound brahma vidya, then you should also invoke brahma vidya, the favor of brahma vidya. So instead of invoking brahma vidya, how come Bhashyakara is seen to invoke the favor of or remembers these devatas and Veda? Saeva hi vaktavya iti. It is proper only that it is brahma vidya that should be invoked. Ityadah brahma vidya sampradaya kartrubhya. Because these devatas are brahma vidya sampradaya kartara. Because they are the promulgators of the tradition of brahma vidya, and therefore by saluting them brahma vidya gets saluted. Etesham tat means brahma vidya sampradaya kartrutve vamsha brahmanam pramanayati, that all of these are brahma vidya sampradaya kartara, that they are the links in the whole chain of the brahma vidya, and therefore by saluting them brahma vidya is saluted. How do you say that they are the promulgators of brahma vidya? How? Vamsha rushibhya, says footnote number 11, footnote number 10, vaktavya brahma vidya yesham anugrahat prapta te gurava sadai vandyayati shishtachara paripalanaya te namaskriyanti iti bodhyamityah. Vaktavya brahma vidya means what? Yesham anugrahat prapta, sa prapta, must be, or whatever it is. So, by the grace of whom this brahma vidya has been acquired by us? Te gurava sadaiva vandyaha yesham anugrahat prapta. Te gurava sadaiva vandyaha. These gurus should always, they are always worth saluting, because by the grace of the teachers alone this brahma vidya has been acquired. Iti shishtachara paripalanaya te namaskriyante iti bodhyam. Therefore, the gurus are always saluted. So this Advaita, even for Shankaracharya, that Advaita is given up or is set aside when it comes to the teacher. So he also salutes the teacher. Salutation always involves a duality. So apakarsha bodhanukula vyaparah, placing oneself at a lower pedestal, and the one who is saluted is placed at a higher pedestal, there is an acceptance of duality. So this vyavaharic duality of this nature is accepted even by such great Acharya Shankaracharya, because even though bhava advaitam sada kuryat, as far as the drashti is concerned, the advaita is there, but that advaita should not be applied when it comes to vyavahara with the guru. Even though in your mind there may be advaita with the guru also, but when it comes to vyavahara, that advaita is not applied. And so Shankaracharya says those gurus are always to be saluted, by the grace of whom this brahma vidya has been acquired by us. That is shishtachara. And vamsha rishibhya, as we said earlier, so vamsha brahmanam, so that will come here, vamsha brahmanam, says here, yadyapi tatra pautimashyadeha brahmantaha sampradayakartaraha shruyante, tathapi guru shishya kramena brahmanaha prathamyam iti tadadityam iti bhavaha. You go to page 665 in this text here. That's the last one.
Atha vamshaha pautimashyaha gaubhavanat gaubhavanaha pautimashyat pautimashyo gaubhavanat gaubhavanaha kaushikat kaushikaha kaundinyat kaundinyaha shandilyat shandilyaha kaushikachya gautamachya gautamaha. And like this the whole thing goes on. How this vidya came to this teacher from the other teacher. So it begins the description, the whole the list begins with Pautimashya. But Pautimashya is the last one. Pautimashya acquired this from Gaubhavana. Gaubhavana acquired from again another Pautimashya because it's a family name. Who acquired from another Gaubhavana, and Gaubhavana from Kaushika, Kaushika from Kaundinya, Kaundinya from Shandilya. In this manner, Sanagach, Sanagaha, Parameshtinaha, so then Sanaraha, Sanaruhu, Sanatana, Sanataha, Sanagach, Sanagaha, Parameshtinaha, Parameshti, Brahmanaha, Brahma, Swayambhu, Brahmane Namaha. That's why he said Parameshti Prabhutaha. So all these are also saluted because Brahma to Parameshti, Parameshti to Sanat Kumar, Sanat Kumar to Sanatana, that's how the Brahma Vidya came down to us. So Brahma is the very first teacher. And Pautimashya is the last teacher. And therefore, says Anandagiri, Yadyapi tatra Pautimashyadayo Brahmandaha Sampradayakartaraha Shuyante. In this particular Vamsha, this chapter, we find that all the Brahma Vidya Sampradayakartaraha, those the promulgators of Brahma Vidya, beginning from Pautimashya, ending with Brahma. But that is the Tathabi Guru Shishya Kramena Brahmana Prathamyat. So this is Shishya Guru Krama. Begin with Pautimashya to Guru, begin with Shishya to Guru Krama. So it looks as though Pautimashya is first. How come Bhashyakara salutes Brahmadibhyam? Brahma is mentioned the last in that chapter. Pautimashya is mentioned first. So Pautimashya, that's how it has been stated. So even though Pautimashya's name appears first in that chapter, in fact is last. So by the Pathakrama, Pautimashya is first. By Arthakrama, he is the last. Arthakrama, Brahmaji is the first and Pautimashya is the last. And therefore, from the compared to Pathakrama, Arthakrama has a greater strength, you know. So Pathakramat, Arthakramat, Baliha. So it is stronger. So anyway, therefore it is said, Tathabi, Guru Shishya Kramena, Tathabi, number 12. Tathabi di Arthakrama Vashyati di Sheshaha. Pathakramat, Arthakrama, Baliyani di Nyayat. So Arthakrama is always is stronger or more important than Pathakrama. And therefore, adopting the Arthakrama, so in reality the Sampradaya began with Brahmaji, therefore Brahmadibhya, beginning from Brahma. The Vamsha Rushi starts with Pautimashya, but in fact, actually it starts with Brahmaji, by Arthakrama. Brahmana Prathamyat. Prathamyat means iti Arthakramad Ashranat. Brahmana Prathamyat iti, on account of the Arthakrama Ashraya, tad adityam iti bhavah, brahma adityam iti bhavah. Shishyaha gurushu adaratisham, tad adityam iti teshu sampradaya kartrasu, brahmana adityam uktam, that's okay. So, Brahmaji the first and therefore Brahmadibhya. It's simple thing. Sampradi aparagurun namaskaroti, and also then our salutation to his own teacher. Namo gurubhya. Yadyapi Brahma Vidya Sampradaya Kartrantarbhavadehite Pragaiva Namaskrutaha. Isn't it that your Guru also is a part of the chain of Brahma Vidya Sampradaya Kartrantarbhavadehite? Yes, definitely. So even though when we said Brahmaji, other devatas are included, and when we said Brahma Vidya Sampradaya Kartrantarbhavadehite, then our Gurus are also included, even then. So Yadyapi Brahma Vidya Sampradaya Kartrantarbhavadehite Pragaiva Namaskrutaha Tathapi Shishyanam Guru Vishayat Atirekayartham Pruthak Guru Namaskaranam. So, Tathabi Shishyanam Guru Vishayat Guru Vishayat Atirekayartham. That's right. So, Guru Vishayat Atirekayartham. That for the Guru there must be Atirekayartham. So that Shishyaha Gurushu Adaratisham Kurvantu Iti Bodhaitum. ఆదర అతిరేక కార్యార్థం, దట్స్ హౌ ఇట్ ఇస్. సో గురు విషయ ఆదర అతిరేక కార్యార్థం, ఫర్ షోయింగ్ ది ఆదర అతిరేక, షోయింగ్ ది అబండెన్స్ ఆఫ్ రెవరెన్స్ ఫర్ ద టీచర్స్. సో ఇట్ ఇస్ సెయిడ్ ఇన్ ఆర్డర్ ఆల్సో టు ఇండికేట్ దట్ ద డిసైపుల్స్ షుడ్ ఆల్వేస్ హ్యావ్ దిస్ గ్రేట్ రెవరెన్స్ ఫర్ ద టీచర్స్, దట్ ఈస్ హౌ ది డిసైపుల్స్ షుడ్ హ్యావ్. ఇది బోధయితుం, సో శిష్యా గురుషు ఆదర అతిశయం కురువంతు ఇది బోధయితుం. దట్స్ వై ది శిష్టాచార భాష్యకర్ ఆల్సో డస్ ఇట్ ఇన్ ఆర్డర్ టు కన్వే దట్ ది డిసైపుల్స్ షుడ్ హ్యావ్ అ గ్రేట్ రెవరెన్స్ ఫర్ ద టీచర్. అదర్వైజ్ నీడ్ నాట్ బి స్పెసిఫికలీ మెన్షన్. వెన్ వి మెన్షన్ సమ్వన్ స్పెసిఫికలీ, అ రెవరెన్స్ ఇస్ షోన్. అమంగ్ బ్రాహ్మణాస్ వెన్ పరిభ్రాజక ఇస్ మెన్షన్ స్పెసిఫికలీ, రెవరెన్స్ ఇస్ షోన్ టు ద పరిభ్రాజక. అండ్ ఆల్సో అమంగ్ ఆల్ ద టీచర్స్ వెన్ యూ మెన్షన్ యువర్ గురు, దట్ షోస్ ఏ గ్రేట్ రెవరెన్స్. టు షో ద రెవరెన్స్ యూ ఆల్వేస్ మెన్షన్ దెమ్ సెపరేట్లీ. పృథక్ గురు నమస్కరణం యస్య దేవే పరాభక్తి ఇత్యాది శ్రుతే ఇత్యర్థః. ఫుట్నోట్ నంబర్ 17, మంగళభాష్య వ్యాఖ్య పరిసమాప్తి అర్థః ఇతి ఇది. సో శ్రుతే ఇతి యస్య దేవే పరాభక్తి యథా దేవే తథా గురౌ తస్యేదే కథితాహ్యర్థః ప్రకాశంతే మహాత్మనః. సో దిస్ ఇస్ ది శ్వేతాశ్వరత శృతి. వన్ వేస్ ది రెవరెన్స్, గ్రేట్ రెవరెన్స్ ఫర్ ద లార్డ్, అండ్ ద సేమ్ రెవరెన్స్ వన్ హ్యాస్ ఫర్ ద టీచర్. To those disciples, to those great people, these meaning of the Upanishad words will reveal themselves. And keeping that in mind, Bhashyakara shows an extra reverence for the teacher. And thus does the Mangalacharanam. In order to establish Shishtachara, also to invoke the grace and the prayer that all the obstacles on our path be eliminated. And that's how the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad Bhashya begins.